Good morning. I just have one announcement for this morning. Our next session meeting will be on July 20th. So for session members, please put that in your calendar. Are there any other announcements for this morning? Then let us go ahead and, oh, yes.
I'm sorry. The baby bottles, they were due this morning, but if you forgot, which I, a number of people have, and that's perfectly fine. You can either bring it next week or drop it off to me if you're out my way, whatever. I have some surgery this week, so I won't be tending to those for several days, or maybe not even until next week. So please, just at your convenience, you can get them back to me. And I'll wait until I'll update it after.
Thank you. Any other announcements? Then let us begin our worship service. Let us stand for the call to worship. In the midst of life's storms, God is there.
What have we to fear?
In the darkness and terror, God is with us.
Of whom shall we be afraid?
Rise up, people of God, for you are loved and saved.
Thanks be to God.
Our opening hymn today is "This Is My Father's Work."
Thank you.
We listen to the stories of miracles and doubt that these things can happen today. We look at the waves of misfortune, distress, misery, distrust, and anger, and wonder how we can still those waves. We feel the pressures of power and fear flooding into our lives, threatening to drown us, and wonder where you are. Forgive us for the smallness of our faith. Forgive us for our doubts. Help us place our trust in you, Lord. Help us fix our eyes on you and on the ministries to which you have called us. For we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Fear not. God is with us, stilling the storms and raging fears in our lives. Place your trust in God always.
So we trust our faith, God, and believe.
Please be seated. Are there any joys or concerns for us to pray about this morning?
Well, first of all, my husband had his test this past week and he came through it fine and everything was pretty much okay, but they still did not find the beginning of where the bacteria is coming from, although he says he feels fine. So we still will be dealing with some doctors, but we're not as concerned as we were. So the doctor that did his procedure said his insides are good. He's not feeling very good. So we're very, very thankful for that. And this morning I got word. I was to bring David here to church this morning, and finally I had been calling and calling, and I finally got Jeannie, and she said her dad's in the hospital. He's in room 5107. And he has a broken arm. He can fall down the steps on Friday. And he's in an awful lot of pain. And she's concerned. She said for the kind of pain that he's in, what he's complaining about, she doesn't think they have found everything yet. So she's going to be talking. She's leaving right away to catch one doctor that she wanted to see. So she just thinks he maybe needs to have some other tests done or pictures taken or whatever. And from there, she said, a couple days, but then he's going to go to somewhere in Cassidy Village for some rehab. And so she just said that he asked her to make sure that we all know here, and he's asking for prayers. So I'm sure everybody would be glad to do that. He's always praying for people, so we'll be so glad to do that for him.
Definitely. Any other joys or concerns?
Oh, and it is Jefferson Hospital.
Jefferson, yes. It's good to have Donna back with us. Then let us go ahead and pray. Lord of wind and water, of calmness and peace, we ask that you be with us this day. Calm all of our fears that we face when we face uncertain futures. Help us relinquish control and place our trust totally in you. Remind us to continue to faithfully work for good, with gratitude for the many blessings that you have poured down upon us. When the waves and torrents threaten us, let us again turn to you, remembering your saving mercies and love. Lord, give us courage to become disciples who can calm the seas of doubt and anger, bringing hope and peace to others. Gracious God, plant a mustard seed of faith in us, so that we can flourish in the midst of those difficult times, and allow that seed of faith to grow continually in our lives. This day, Lord, we especially give thanks for fathers and for father figures in our lives as we celebrate their work and example among us. As they planted the seeds of wisdom and courage, of faithfulness and care, compassion and strength in our own lives. Lord, allow them to celebrate this day in honor and gratitude for your work in their lives. Today, Lord, as we brought before you situations that require help and healing mercies, remind us again that you are with each person and with every situation, offering your love and mercy. We thank you for the many ways that you have healed us, for all the goodness that you have poured down upon us. For these we offer our prayers of gratitude and love. Today we lift up to you Tom and are thankful that his procedure went okay. We still lift up his healing journey as they continue to try and discover what might be causing the infection. We also lift up to you, Dave Cairn. We ask that you work your healing powers in his body. Lord, there are lots of unspoken prayers that we offer up to you now in a moment of silence. Lord, in one voice, your people lift up their voice together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our Old Testament scripture reading today is a rather long story, but a familiar one to probably most of you, if not all of you. It comes from 1 Samuel, and I'm sure as I begin reading it in chapter 17, you will recognize it. And there came out from the camp of the Philistines a champion named Goliath, a Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a helmet of bronze on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail. The weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. He had greaves of bronze on his legs and a javelin of bronze slung between his shoulders. The shaft of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron, and his shield bearer went before him. He stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why have you come out to draw up for battle? Am I not a Philistine, and are you not servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves and let him come down to me. If he is able to fight with me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and serve us." And the Philistine said, "Today I defy the ranks of Israel. Give me a man that we may fight together." When Saul and all Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Now dropping down to verse 32. David said to Saul, "Let no one's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine." Saul said to David, "You are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are just a boy, and he has been a warrior from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant used to keep sheep for his father, and whenever a lion or a bear came and took a lamb from the flock, I went after it and struck it down, rescuing the lamb from its catch, from its mouth. And if it turned against me, I would catch it by the jaw, strike it down, and kill it. Your servant has killed both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them, since he has defied the armies of the living God." David said, "The Lord who saved me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear will save me from the hand of this Philistine." So Saul said to David, "Go, and may the Lord be with you." Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a bronze helmet on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail. David strapped Saul's sword over his armor, and he tried in vain to walk, for he was not used to them. Then David said to Saul, "I cannot walk in these, for I am not used to them." So David removed them. Then he took his staff in his hand, chose 5 smooth stones from the wadi, and put them in his shepherd's bag, in the pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. The Philistine came on and drew near to David with his shield bearer in front of him. When the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. The Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the field." But David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This very day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head, and I will give the dead bodies of the Philistine army this very day to the birds of the air and to the wild animals of the earth, so that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not save by sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand." When the Philistine drew near to meet David, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. David put his hand in his bag, took out a stone, slung it, and struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground. Now, Now turning to our gospel lesson today, we go to Mark chapter 4, beginning in verse 30. He also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on the earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs, and puts forth large branches so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." With many such parables, he spoke the word to them, as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on a cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this man that even the wind and the sea obey him?" Thanks be to God for the reading of God's holy word. This morning, I am deeply indebted to Reverend Kara English for the idea of today's sermon, which in large measure she offered to her own presbytery as source material. In the book Imagining the Small Church, Celebrating a Simpler Path by Steve Willis, he writes in the introduction of the book that this book boasts no 10 or 15 steps to being a successful small church. Instead, I hope to encourage you to give up on steps altogether, and even to give up on success, at least how success is usually measured. I also hope to help the reader imagine the small church differently, to see with new eyes the joys and pleasures of living small and sustainably. As I mentioned, I keep reading over and over how the church was in trouble long before the pandemic hit, and now how we are seriously in trouble, as if we are right now out on the lake with Christ in the midst of a storm. But Christ asks, with what do we measure a church's success? What metrics do we use to describe it? As Presbyterians, we tend to be less chatty than some other denominations about the number of souls we've saved. But we still measure our vital statistics in the number of people that are in our pews and the number of dollars that's in our bank account. Because at the end of the year, the presbytery wants to know. At the end of the year, the Office of General Assembly Statistics want to know. And even in casual conversations when I'm at gatherings, that is the first question people ask me when they find out that I'm a minister. How many members do you have? How many people attend your services? Larger numbers must mean better success, and dwindling numbers must mean failure, or maybe even death. How in the world are we to keep people coming to church? The notion that Christianity is dying, that if we don't start growing soon, we will pass from simply being irrelevant to being non-existent, sounds scary. But you know, I need to tell you that it has been selling books and workshops to anxious pastors and congregational members for all of the 35 years that I've been in ministry. Will we grow or will we die is the question that gets posed as if the numbers are the only story of our church's relevance. And always the next move is then to ask already stressed out pastors, what steps are you taking to save the church? I have to tell you, I have seriously read every 5-step, 9-step, 12-step, 15-step book to grow a successful church. And the truth is, there are no steps other than 1 foot in front of the next. There is no solution, only perhaps a deeper dive into the vulnerability of being the church, wherever it is that we are planted. Because Jesus isn't the one that's calling us to save the church. Let me propose that instead, Jesus calls us to simply be the church over and over again, to plant seeds, to share stories, to try and live just a little bit more ethically, morally, and thoughtfully for the welfare of other human beings. With what shall we compare the kingdom of God? What parable shall we use for it? Jesus says. And Jesus' answer is not the kingdom of God is like a profitable corporation. Jesus' answer wasn't that the kingdom of God is like a sold-out auditorium. Jesus' answer wasn't that the kingdom of God is like receiving a huge financial windfall. Instead, the answer was, the kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. A mustard seed? A mustard seed. The kingdom of God is like a tiny seed that's planted so it can grow. Then when it does grow, it becomes a home, a nest, a habitat for a variety of birds who will come and go as they please. If we want to grow like the kingdom of God, like the community of the faithful that Jesus was talking about, we cannot let those articles or even statistics about being a dying church scare us. Fear not, my friends. We have to embrace that the church will hold 1,000 funerals, bury what used to be, and do so willingly. If Christians can't talk about, let alone embrace, the power of endings to give rise to something new, then what is the point of the whole narrative of the gospel, the passion that Jesus was a part of? Because that's our story. This is where we shine. Because they thought Jesus was dead. They buried him. Jesus told his followers over and over again that the ending was necessary, that it had a purpose, that it was indeed essential to the story. But they really didn't quite get it. They couldn't quite imagine that he would have to be buried, planted in the earth to die, but then rise again. You know, it was in 2007 that I started my first ministry in this area at Olivet Presbyterian Church. And we had our first conversation there about being a dying church. Everyone was looking at the numbers. And as is the case in most small congregations, those numbers painted a pretty grim story of limitations. There could only be a couple of years of paying a full-time pastor, and Olivet would face immediate financial struggles. because there really were no active, or there were no children actively involved in the church at that time. The congregational members were discouraged. Fears that we might die were at the forefront of everyone's thoughts. And in the midst of those fears, Olivet decided to go to part-time ministry, which a few years later became a partnership with another congregation, Bethesda U, because Bethesda went through the very same anxiety at about the same time period. And yet, 14 years later when this all began, 14 years, we're all still here. You, me, and them. We still ask those same questions. We still are in fear some days. We're still living in the same, very same reality that we were living in 14 years ago. The fearfulness of being caught up in the storms of life and being capsized by the waves of death remains a fact, a truth, a reality. But you know what? So does living. So does the resurrection to something new remain a fact of the gospel message we proclaim every day, every Sunday, every season, every year. We are here only by the grace of God. And you know what? It is time for us to embrace that and truly live into it. You know, there are lots of assumptions that we have to bury about success. But as we bury them, what we're really doing is planting seeds of faithfulness, of trust in our living God to do something with our limited resources. But there are still resources. Okay, so we can't be, and we aren't going to be, the church that we were in 1950. Or we can't be, and we're not going to be, the church that we were in 1970. Okay, we're not going to be, and we can't be, the church that we were in 1990. Okay, we can't be, and we won't be, even the church that we were in 2019. From this day forward, it is more important for us to be what we can be. To simply be the church. By letting go of past expectations, we'll find that Christ stills those waters of anxiety, and we will start to fling mustard seeds everywhere. And as we continue to face new challenges, and believe me, I know we will, there are still more challenges to come. We'll need to start to think about success in new ways. It won't be by those same old metrics or the same old script to boost our numbers or to fail as a church. The growth will instead be in our spirit of those who are here, who have been in the boat with Christ, who have planted the mustard seeds in the neighborhood, in authentically embracing what we can be, not fuss about what we used to be or can't be. Valuing productivity and proliferation as what it means to be successful amplifies a cultural message, not a spiritual one. For our small church to not just exist, but to thrive, we have to quit believing in the message that our numbers are what tell the story of who we are and our ministry. Because that message becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. If God has truly planted us here for a purpose where we are, then let us celebrate the mustard growing right here, where the local birds can make their nests and come and go as they please and learn to fly. So let us be like the mustard seed, Bury the church as it used to be and watch what might grow in that place. I know that that is a scary proposition, especially for those of us who look at numbers. I know that the storms of doubt will inevitably come when we embrace that idea. But you know what? We are not in the boat alone. Christ is there beside us to calm our fears, to quiet the waves of doubt. We need to give the church at large, you know, the one with the capital C, a new message, a lesson in actually being the church. Because the size and impact of a congregation is not going to be measured by butts and bucks, but instead by the size of our hearts and our love of Christ for others. It will be measured by the spirit of a people who sat terrified in the boat of doubt, but watched as the Lord calmed our fears while we then planted a mustard seed of faith and embraced a resurrection to new life. That is the gospel message. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now let us calm our hearts and minds as we focus on God's thanksgiving in our lives and all the blessings that we have bestowed, He has bestowed on us. Sustains us, even for your discipline that corrects us, for your patience that holds us, and for your love that redeems us. Give us the boldness to share your love with others and the joy of thankfulness and all these gifts. For we offer them to you in service. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our closing hymn is "The God of Abraham Prays." Go in peace, and remember that God goes with you.